the altar here is for the goddess of time. The goddess of time is who I very often invocate with all kind of things, and I Ching and all kind of other things in Taoism are related to this, and it shows a lot of relationship with other religions like Buddhism and Hinduism. Yuanzhen has her birthday on September 9th of the lunar calendar. She's also called Doumu. She's accompanied by 60 attendants, and each of them is part of the 60-year calendar. They all belong to the birth date of Yu. So you each have your own birth date for that. The goddess of time, or Doumu, she is married to the King of Heaven, and together they are divided as the seven stars of the Big Dipper plus two, and also at the same time the Small Dipper is there too. They are separated by a dragon, a star system called Draco, which separates the two apart from each other, and you can recognize the character of Qi in that, where they separate the yang and the yin. The upper part is the yang and the lower part is the yin, representing the earth. The Big Dipper has nine stars, and we see only seven, two of them are hidden, and these are called the nine kings of the great god. And these nine stars, these nine gods, they also play a role in Nadam practice within the nine cavities of your body. The goddess of time herself, we call her very often the mysterious lady of the nine heavens, Jiu Tian Xuan Mu. Grandmother West Siwa Mu is in many traditions seen as exactly the same as the goddess of time. There is no consensus about it though. There are schools who see them as two different ones, so that is very important. One other name is that she is called the mother of the Zinuba baby, which in the Dantian is also called the spiritual embryo by Westerners. And this is the beginning of the immortal life as a result of your Nadam practice. And of course, Siwa Mu is the mother, the guardian, basically, of the immortalists, the protected deity, but also the one who allows you to eat from the peach of immortality. The fruit of immortality.
We have to ask ourselves a few questions.
The process of the movement of Qi, the Draco, and the Big and the Small Dipper, and the whole Nadam practice is actually represented in our body as the circulation of the yin and the yang through the Tumai and the Renmai, which is also called the Xiao Zhou Tian, the small heavenly circle. And a large heavenly circle is the circulation of the Dipper around the polar disappearance point. That is North Pole, is a void. And so this is the origin of all existence, and which we call the existence, we also call the Yuan Dongxi. That is the one and the four zeros, the one one and the four zeros, which are together connecting all the things between the east and the west along the running course of the big rivers of China. The 60 constellations around it, or Xia, they correspond with the 60 directional aspects of the earth also at the same time. And it is this circulation of this 60 Xia which are relevant in the context of Chinese New Year. Because every year there is another god of the Xia which presides the heavenly constellations. The different heavenly constellations, they also control the years of somebody's birth. So the year that you're born in, the god of the year that you're born in, is relevant in relationship to your horoscope. So it is not so much the 12 animals as people usually show you, but it is actually these 60 Jia that are important, and that you move throughout your life. And these 60 Jia, they're all the time different. So you're not just going through the 12 animals every 12 years, but you actually go through 60 Xia and these 60 Sha, they are different. They are ruled by different aspects, and they also do different aspects to your life. And the point is, of course, to grow by recognizing and respecting the values of these different Sha. That is a study that can take a lifetime. But there's two Sha that you really need to know. That is primarily your birth Sha and the Sha of the year that you are in. Of course, the Chinese New Year is the beginning of the spring, and the beginning of the spring is also the celebration of the new rule, the new Sha. The 16 Sha, you have to understand in themselves, they are guided by Dong Wu, actually moves the constellations. That is basically the rule. And so it means that all the 60 year gods, they are obliged to Dong Wu. What is important, of course, is also that this is the cycling of the yin and the yang through space. And this movement of the yin and yang through space corresponds with the circulation of the yin and yang inside your body, and is therefore called the Da Zhou Tian. The cycle of heaven, we have to reconcile the yin and the yang, we have to reconcile the ghost and the gods, we have to reconcile the wind and the rain, and as a result of that, we have to drive what is called the 12 white tigers and the 9 green dragons. And the 9 green dragons are the 9 heavenly kings, and the 12 white tigers are earthly forces. All the different gods of the body and heaven under your control. The basic outlay for this practice is explained in the Bao Bu Zi by Ge Hong, one of the main writers about Neidam practices in the beginning of the history of this. Anyway, in this way you learn therefore the pathway of existence as being said in Taoism. Everything outside of Beiji is different, differentiated in a different way. Beiji itself is still prenatal, but everything else is postnatal. So that means that the 10,000 things, the gods, the ghosts, the demons, and so forth, they all are postnatal. And that means that they draw because of their nearness to the prenatal, maybe from the prenatal, but in effect, they're all postnatal. That means they are more similar to us than to the prenatal, which is formless and directionless, as you know. And Dong Wu moves everything around, so she's basically part of the Tao in the sense that she moves things around in such a way that actually the Tao can do its work and things become whatever they are at the moment when they have become. The heavenly dragon, like I said, moves around the Beiji point, and this is called the Tianlong, the heavenly dragon. There are particular meditations for the heavenly dragon, which I also teach in the Taoist practice. And you have to also assimilate this inside to be able to make this differentiation between the small and the big chariots of the heavenly king and queen. When we look at this symbol, we see that this whole movement and the dragon movement between, they are the movements of death and life, yin and yang, both absence and presence in existence. In the Shenmu Pai, the Draco is the snake actually curling around the turtle, and as a result of that you can say that the turtle itself represents heaven and earth, and the Draco is moving between them, and you can see that it is actually the star system in heaven, which is associated with Xuanwu, the god of the north. And now you know why he is associated with the north, because he basically is the god of this place and is a heavenly king. The shield of the turtle is heaven, of course, and the belly, the plastron, is the earth. But when you look at the Chinese New Year, the ritual year starts off for your time meditations with the third day of the third month, which is both the birthday of Chen Wu, but also it is the day of Xuan Wu, of the goddess of time. because it's her birthday, so we have to celebrate the birthday of the goddess of time, of course, Siwa Mu. At the 16th of the 10th month is also the celebration of the water god. And the water god celebration is very important because it shows how the faiths of people are established on the basis of their behavior throughout the year. And in this time, the water god cuts basically the knot on your life at that moment, and he basically determines what your life next year is going to be. The only influence you have is trying to behave good under all the difficult circumstances that are being presented to you. When you give in to the bad circumstances and you also start behaving bad or destructive or anything like that, of course, then the next year you have a worse fate. So this is how you gradually teach the water god to give you a better or a worse fate. Now that's the whole point. Then at the moment when the Chinese New Year starts, which is a 14-day process, which you can see in the accompanying paper, then at that moment you can say, okay, now the new year starts. So you start working on the improvement of your life that you want, and then the values of that particular year are going to start. And the 5 days before, you start to say goodbye to the old year qualities. You do ceremonies to make sure that your house is clean, and on the new year day you put out the character signs, which are based on the story of Nian. And Nian was sort of a monster that people learned from, that you can chase them away. Nian would harass you the whole year through, and then you could chase it away by waving with red flags and also making popping noises like with firecrackers. The Nian itself is a monster from either below the sea or from below the mountains. It depends on which area of China you were. So that is not so very important. What is important though is that the New Year story is related to the Chinese classic, the Shanghai Lun, which is the classic of the seas and the mountains, which is a text about monsters living outside of the periphery of China. And that was actually all foreigners in that sense. They were considered monsters. So everybody who was not Chinese or not from within China is a monster. And that is part of the myth of Chinese culture.
As you can see, Douma has 8 arms. 2 of them have a mudra. 1 of them has a bow and arrow. 1 of them has a bell. 1 of them has the sun. 1 of them the moon. And 1 a seal. And 1 a stick, a cudgel. And these are the weapons of battling time.
The official title of Doumu is Doumu Yuanjun, First Lady Doumu. She has many other names like Tianho, Taiyi Yuanjun, Doumu, of course, Tianmu, Mother of Heaven, Goddess of Time. Doumu is surrounded by the 60 so-called year gods. These rule the fates of the people born in a particular year or the fates of a particular year. And yes, that is a different story than the story that you normally hear from your astrologer about Taoist and Chinese astrology. This is the way how actually in Taoism time is actually perceived, and every year has its god that you need to revert to make sure that your fate is in your favor. You understand, of course, that the Chinese calendar is not natural to ours. In our Gregorian calendar, we start every cycle in 1924, 1984 and so forth. Every 60 years a new cycle, and it ends in our 1983 cycle or 2043 in our near future. You can see that looks irregular. There are 3 major points of attention in managing your year god and the god of the year that you are living in, of course. That's actually 5 then. That is that first of all you have to pay respect to Doumu at her birthday. That is the birthday of Siwa Mu actually, and that is in the beginning of the year. Then you have to pay attention to the celebration of the water god, and we have a video on this already and you find the link below. And the other one is of course the spring festival, and this is the time that we now talk about, and this is when you celebrate your worship of the year god and of the year god of your birth, so that these two can negotiate with each other and manage your birth, your life and the coming year. Of course, it is important to have good behavior, because the year god, no, not the year god, the water god actually determines if you behave properly enough, so that you, you know, can have the right to have a good life in the year that you are in. Otherwise, your fate is already set. So whatever is happening in the coming year, you cannot change anymore at this point. But before the water god makes the new faiths, you can adapt your behavior as good as possible, and as a result of that, you can actually improve the year after. You see here the hole in my cards. I lost one card of this set. That's a pity. Every year god has its own image, and whatever temple you go to in China, whether it's in Beijing, or if it is in Shanghai, or if it is in Xi'an, or in Chengdu, you find these year gods, and they all represent particular kind of things. And here, this is the year god that we are currently living in, and this is the year god from next year, and this is the year god from my birth, actually, that is from the year after, and we'll get back on that later. The calendar and the time calculation that is based on the 60-year cycle is based on the lunar cycle. That means that these 60, they are called Xia, and these 60 Xia, they are spread out over a period of 60 years, and they repeat every 60 year in a slightly different manner, because the moon of course is always different. That means that in respect to our Gregorian calendar, the year always starts at a different date in the year, but also at a different time every cycle again. So the year at the beginning of the year is all the time different, which is very confusing when you have to calculate somebody's birthday and they calculate in the old moon calendar, or the farmer's calendar as we call it nowadays. And when they calculate like that, you have to also calculate that if you are not very good in calculating that like that. This is also of course why there's all these calendars always in the market, so you can look it up if you understand what to look for. You see, every card has several information, namely the name of the god, but also the year cycle, the place in the year cycle where they are.
On the plaques, you can here see the dates. The dates are here written in the format of the Chinese script, and this one is 61 actually. 63 should be close by here. 62. This is here. This actually is the god of my year.
By the way, the farmer calendar is not just a 60-year cycle, but the 60-year cycle is divided in two groupings of 10 and of 12 years, the earthly branches and the heavenly stems. And these are the heavenly and the earthly measurements of time. Like I said, this is the god of this year, and you see that he is tied up between two different gods from last year and next year, and both have a sword. The one has a Tao, the one from last year, so it's a very aggressive year, and the one from next year, the tiger year, actually also is a weaponized year. But this year is the year of the ox, of course, which is a very different and much more peaceful year to compare with the two other years. So to show you a little bit, the next one, 2023, that is my birth year, my birth year cycle, so then my cycle actually comes back, and then at that year I have to worship only one god. The year god that I have also, of course, is flanked on both sides by two different kind of years. And these years, they are things that I have to take into account every time. And when you look at all the years as a whole, you see that my year is tied up between the different cycles also, and you can see similarities between the different kind of gods. But this is the counting of the Gregorian calendar. And the Gregorian calendar is of course not the original calculation as we should have it within our calculation. So when you look at the calculations as a whole, you can see there are some problems with the association with the Western calendar, which can only overcome by looking at the calendar as a whole. This is the 12-year branch calendar. The 12-year branch calendar is showing you actually the original earthly or moon-like combination of years in cycles of 12, and there are of course 5 cycles of 12 in a year, and you can see within these different years the different kind of yin aspects of the different years they come and match together. As is also scientifically proven, the cycle of the moon of course moves the waters of the earth also in our body, and therefore also controls a little bit our sleep cycle, our emotions, and so on and so on. They can of course influence ourselves in a positive or in a negative way, so it is important to watch this. And of course, when you find your birth year somewhere in this cycle, you can understand a little bit about where you are in this cycle, so you understand a little bit how the year is actually built up. And we see that the year is built up in cycles of 20, that's actually based on the heavenly stems. And in these cycles of 20, you have like the upper, the beginning 20, the middle, and the lower sequence, that's the last year. And in this 12 cycle you have 5 stages, which are like 5 groupings of 12 years, which in themselves also are subdivided, and we can say that these 12 cycles are actually the Wu Xing cycle. So these 12 years go through different Wu Xing steps. At the moment when you look at this cycle, you see that as a result of that your placement of your year god is in the earth cycle and in the heaven cycle different, so it's not the same. And it is interesting to see how that changes, because then you can understand that from the earthly perspective your faith is very different than from the heavenly perspective. And to understand this difference actually helps you to make predictions about your future destiny in the coming years as they are coming. At the moment when you study this way of looking at time under the guidance of the studies of Domu, you see that in a particular ordering like this, the regularity and the ordering of the earth cycle, that particular gods in particular cycles are, you know, similar. You can see that there are similarities, and they are not similar in the same way as you would normally perceive, but you can see, okay, there is the 5 different or the 12 different animals, and 5 times they are different. This is the different Wu Xing cycles. If you look at my god in this cycle, you see that the ordering within the whole of the year is completely different, and the whole larger cycle of 12 also is very different. And you can see that you're embedded in a particular ordering through which you can understand what kind of growth processes you want to expect. When you look in the cycles of 10 years, on the other hand, you see that it is different again. And here's where you see the separation in cycles of 20, the upper, the middle, and the lower, as I discussed above. And you can see that the sun cycle gives a completely new order again, and because of that you can see specific things also which are relevant. My heavenly god in that sense aspect is at the middle end of the lower cycle. That means that we are nearing an ending of a cycle very soon. So 2023 is the end of my year, then it means then that 2033 is the end of this 60-year cycle. So this is basically how you can calculate yourself through all kind of things, and you can see that that is actually a very ordered and regular cycle that is coming back all the time. So every 60 years the same cycle of 60 comes back, so this ordering is very important. When you do feng shui, you can measure on the basis of this kind of calculations what is going to be the fate of your house also, depending on the contract that you bought it or on the day on which you bought it, that it was being built. I'm sorry for my lapse of consciousness in my talking. If you look at the Taoist calendar, the festival calendar, you see that all kind of events, they are connected with each other, and these connections, they are very important because during the year they are meant to help you concentrate on how you actually give direction to your life and to your faith, and especially when you become an immortal, if you want to become an immortal, which of course is logical that you want that. At the moment when you are working to become an immortal, it becomes much more important to enhance your moral value so that you are eventually allowed access to the heavenly realms and can avoid going into the earthly realms, which we call usually the world of hell, which we talked about also in other movies, for which you also will see some links below. And then you can see that the heavenly and the earthly realm, they are closely linked, and they have their own pantheon in which particular gods and demons are important. They are called the Kuai Shen, and the Kuai Shen is the ones belonging to heaven or the ones belonging to earth. And here you see my god at the end of the year, and this is the end of the cycle almost. So this is how things eventually end up. You see in this movie there are two markers for you to notice. Now, one is the year god of my birth year, but also the opening where the card is missing, so that you can see that they are all the time in different places, and as a result of that you can see the difference between the Gregorian calendar, the moon calendar and the sun calendar. These are my two gods that I have to worship this coming year. The one is the god of this year, and the other one is my own birth god. And these two have to be negotiating with each other, and of course they're under the guidance of Doma. Just to remind you, this is your god for this year, that even if you don't know your god, just make sure that you have a picture of this, make a screenshot and put it on your wall above your bed or in your kitchen or in your living room. So that you can continuously remind yourself of the fact that you have to respect your life. This is in how far we have discussed the Chinese calculation for the actual astrology that is relevant for calculating somebody's fate in the future, and what is going to happen and what you can do, and the ritual part to resolve your issues with life. When we go to the more ordinary horoscopes, people always talk about the 12 animals. So let's get into that and use the 12 animal symbols to give you a little bit of an idea of what you can expect in the coming year, the ox year. In the ox year, in general, we can say that things look much less easy to achieve success than in the red year. The red year, as you know, is pretty much an opportunistic year, what we have seen in the last year. And in the red year, working with your relationships to get doors open that are normally closed, and to get things that normally stay out of your reach, or to assume things that are not actually yours, stealing, achieving things through mischievous ways is relatively easy to achieve. When we talk about the ox year, these kind of things, they are not really an option. The ox year is a year where people really have to work to get results, and this is not going to be an easy year because discipline is required to get results from things in a year like the ox year. And this is the metal ox year, so that is actually double so. As you know, metal ore does not come out of the ground by itself, so you have to do work to get the metal ore out. Then you have to do work and you have to coordinate all kinds of actions to make sure that the metal ore gets cleaned and eventually becomes tools. And this is where it becomes interesting, because then the tools, they can collect water. This is in the Wuxing cycle, of course. The water can feed the plants can be burned and create ashes, the ashes can collapse, can pile up and eventually become soil, and the soil eventually can produce metal ore. But then of course somebody has to be taking it out. And that means that this natural cycle in the Wuxing thinking is what makes the horoscope actually interesting, because there's years where things go by itself and there's years where things do not go by itself. And after a red year, when you're used to being an opportunist, then this year is going to be like a smack in your face and trying to put you in the wrong direction. And this is a lot about morality this year. So it is the morality of how you achieve things, and that is what is going to be difficult. There are three animals that are seen as being harmonious with each other. That is, there are different groups of three, but in this case we talk about the ox triangle. That is the ox with the phoenix and the snake. And at the moment when you see these animals together, you see that they are having certain kind of things which are similar, but they're also very different. The phoenix, for instance, in its being similar than the ox, where the ox is very staying at home-like, a little bit like the hare. The phoenix is really outgoing because it likes to shine and it likes to show off its power, while the ox in itself is pretty much shy and modest in a particular way. The snake, similar. Now, they have very similar qualities like the ox, and they are sympathetic to things and they understand things, they can think about things. But on the other hand, the ox keeps everything plain and simple, while the snake, it needs intrigue. If there's no intrigue, for instance, the ox is usually very reliable. It's very rarely that you see an ox which is a devious ox. But the snake, on the other hand, because of his need for intrigue, he would be sometimes a little bit unreliable, maybe quite unreliable, say, in some cases, they would be seen as like the antithesis of the ox. If I compare that ox with a creature like me, I am a hare by nature, by birth, then you can see also some particular kind of differences and also some benefits. And this is what I want to explain about the animals and the relationship with the year that they're in. Because in this year, you, in whatever animal you are, you're going to have a relationship with that year animal. And you need to be able to understand it, to be able to bend the year into the direction where you want it eventually. In the case of a hare, hares are usually a little bit frightened creatures, and that's what they say anyway about hares. And they're also very stubborn and so on. A lot of other qualities that can be helpful, can be unhelpful. But in the year of the ox, they usually feel a bit more protected. The ox here is protective for its friends in general. And the hare and the ox, they are pretty good with each other, in the sense that they're both pretty much reliable. And that's not to put feathers in my own butt, but that's just how horoscopes usually think about these kind of things. Both the ox and the hare are pretty much home-directed, so also for them, being by themselves and onto themselves and onto their own inner circle is feeling very comfortable for them. For the hare, of course, the challenge is to make sure that they keep on being outgoing, do not focus too much on a small group, but try to include more people in your family. That's the main thing. That's for me also this year. Of course, fortunately, I have this channel, so I have a big family, and that is already helping me in many ways more than people usually realize. When you are a dragon, the ox here can be a little bit dramatic because the dragon, they really don't like, they don't, the dragons, they flutter about all the time and they go left and right and they show off, you know, how wonderful they are, and they like to be admired and so on. And they're not bad people, they're good people, that's not a problem, but you know, they need some glory, you can say. This is not a glorious year, and the ox year just is not a glorious year. The ox year is a year for hard work, and if you're not willing to do the hard work, you think that everything will come just like that, then you have a little bit of a issue with this year, and you're going to feel some frustration as a result of that. Like I said already, the snake, they need the intrigue, and this is not a good year for intrigue. So they have a hard time to get their stories going, so it will become more obvious for snakes, for other people, that they are intrigued minded, and that their stories might fall through, so to say. For the horse also, this is not necessarily good here for the horse, because a horse is well, a little bit self-centered, and in the ox here, self-centeredness is not that relevant. The horse, because of the restrictions of the ox here, will easily feel impatient because things don't go fast enough, things don't go strong enough. And we have, of course, to deal with the COVID thing. This is a year where we would like to get all the vaccines administrated like a horse would, and just get it over with and then go on with the rest of our year. And this is, of course, the feeling that many people already have because, you know, they were in this opportunistic year last year. A lot of things seemed to be going pretty much okay, even though there was a pandemic, even though there were strange elections all over the world. Now, at this moment, this will change, and the rollout of the vaccine already looks like it's not going to go easy. There's going to be resistance against the vaccine. There is inequality between different countries, like even in within countries, like a country like Israel, where the Palestinians get only a few thousand of vaccines, while the Israelis, of course, get all the vaccines. While the responsibility of the Israeli government is for both of these communities, they have tried to separate in ghettos, of course. That is, of course, difficult, and these are horse kind of things. When governments and countries, they are self-directedly aggrandized, they find themselves really wonderful and exceptional, and then this is a year where they will have difficulties. And in that sense, I have to point out China, which is, as a country, it is a hard-working country, but it's also sometimes a little bit opportunistic. So the opportunistic side will be confrontational towards themselves at this moment. Well, the hard-working side will just pay off, like always. They have taken the lessons from the red tier by being opportunistic, where they could be do that in a wise way or in a smart way, but they were also at the same time working, buffaloing through the things. For the sheep, the sheep abhors hard work, and they don't like discipline and so on. They are like a dreamy kind, and they expect things to come by itself. As a hare, I am in a triangle with pigs and hares and sheep. And we are together, we are like easygoing with each other, so to say. We feel comfortable with each other. And as a result of that, friendship is natural to us. But the sheep has as a disadvantage to the hare, even though emotionally it feels very comfortable. The sheep cannot be moved forward. They move at their own pace. And yeah, that is not really filled with discipline. It's not filled with play too, at the same time. Yeah, because sheep is not unserious, it's just not that much busy. So as a result of that, the year can be a punishment, because it's all the time being urged to discipline itself, and though it is willing, its memory is usually a little bit short, so it doesn't keep on to its discipline all the time. That is the difficulty, probably. So the year passes by on the ship when they are not getting into the discipline. The monkey is another animal which probably is the one that most benefits from the ox year, because the monkey is in its, you know, moving around a little bit like a dragon. It isn't seeking as much glory as the dragon, so as a result of that, the monkey probably is the only animal that will find shortcuts in this year. Monkeys are always a little bit opportunist, like rats, but in a very different way. They have, of course, three dimensions where they can fly through. You have to not think about gorillas, of course, when you think about monkeys, but more about gibbons. The ox year in itself is pretty much like a ordered year. This is something that you have to realize. The ox is ruled by Yin, and Yin is the order, the orderedness of things. It is the compacting of things, getting things together, and as a result of their order, you require to do a particular amount of work to get things done. Yang, on the other hand, is more chaotic because it just goes in all directions and there is not so much connection between the different yang things. So as a result of that, you can say that the yang is more or less the symbol of chaos. So in that sense, we can say that for a year like this, when you are a phoenix, for instance, the phoenix likes to make plans. But it makes plans with itself in the middle, and the orderness of the ox year doesn't give much space for a phoenix to make its own plans be worked, because the ox year asks to work together and to integrate and to get things done through mutual cooperation. And for the phoenix, it's all about, okay, mutual cooperation is fine as long as I can be the boss. It is similar like with the dragon that doesn't really care about the mutual cooperation as long as it can feel like, you know, it is important. If you are a dog, on the other hand, this is a good year for you, because I noticed that a lot of years are actually good years for dogs. The thing is, this Doxus and Oxus, they are in some way they are similar because of their reliability, but the dog is more open-minded, and sometimes the rigid discipline of the ox might be a little bit too much for the dog, and it will try to move the ox here into other directions, and that can sometimes be difficult. But in general, they are very similar, and they know where their loyalties are. The pig, or what in Chinese medicine actually is called the chu, is a boar. They feel more safe in the ox here, and they feel especially safe to show their affections to other people. The chu is a very, well, it is easy to make itself second to somebody else or to other people in general, but in this case, in the year of the ox, they feel more safe to show their affection. The boars can be a little bit chaotic in some things. In that sense, they are very similar, like rats, which is the next sign. This is a year where they can organize themselves and get their life going into the direction that they want. And last year, it was for me a little bit more difficult because everybody seems to want to take opportunity on them. When you look at a rat, of course, we started out with a rat. The rat is getting quite a slap in the face because he's basically going to go to prison. There's no space for opportunism. Rats who have already learned that they have to master themselves a little bit before they go scavenging, they didn't have a bad year. They did not go too far, and they don't have to search their moral consciousness here. So that is, good. It's always good to learn from the new year. I hope you enjoyed this video and that you will have a lot of benefits from this for many years to come. Next year, around this time, there will be a new one. This is about the tiger year. Tiger year, fluffy animals. You're going to have a lot of fun.
I was a tiger. My brothers and my mom's chair always do the narrow one because it's easier. It's more for old people.
Oh, look at him, Isa. Those are echt the Kung Fu master.
Me too.
Yes.
My
daughter's. Oh, your son is also very white. Look at him.
Whoa!
How many minutes?
Okay, Pat. Okay.
Papa.
This is another one, Demi. This is another one. You also do another one, then. Yeah.
How long do I stand here?